Good evening and welcome to the Boulder City United Methodist Worship Service, Christmas Eve service. Friends, we are an inclusive church. It doesn't matter what your background is. It doesn't matter what you've done in your life. It doesn't matter the color of your skin, your ethnicity, or who you love. What does matter is that there is a God who loves you deeply, and this God desires to have a wonderful relationship with you. So as we worship God together, let's make sure we give God our best. Amen. And now join with me in the lighting of the Advent wreath Christmas candle. A reading first from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, and those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy, and they rejoice before you as with the joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Once we were down in the dark, now we glimpse a great light. Thank God we see a new day dawning. What was nothing is turning into something. Terror tried us, storms denied us, injustice angered us, and apathy discouraged us. But thank God today that we see a new day dawning. Oppression giving way to overflow. We see a new day dawning. Burdens becoming blessings. We see a new day dawning. Sadness to salvation. We see a new day dawning. The yoke is broke, a new day is dawning, for a Savior is born for us, wonderful counselor, guide for us, everlasting Father, provider for us, Prince of Peace, drawing near to us. We light the Christ candle to celebrate this joy. It's a new day, and I thank God for it. Let's worship the Lord our God.
Dear friends, the flame of this candle originated in the city of Bethlehem, in the country of Israel. We bring you this light in the spirit of the one who was born there over 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ, the one that the Bible calls the light of the world and the Prince of Peace. The prophet Isaiah long ago spoke these words: "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined." This light gives us hope that even though there is much darkness in the world, we can still see signs of loving and peaceful communities. We still see the people living in harmony and working together for your peace and justice. Please receive the light of this candle as a visible reminder of the mission we share. As believing people, our mission is to keep the hope of peace alive in our world, in our communities, and in our homes.
We thank you for bringing this peace light to us, and may this flame inspire us to commit ourselves to peace, love, justice, and hope. May those we touch each day see this light shining in our lives. As Jesus said, "May your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." We wish you God's blessings and safety as you continue on your journey.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that your light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. Make us ambassadors of your peace in all that we do, think, and say. Bless the flame that we carry and share with others. May it burn brightly in the lives of those who need to hear a word of hope. May it give courage and confidence to all those who face the darkness. Thank you, God, for your light. Amen.
Now, friends, join me in our opening prayer. God of light and love, shine upon us this Christmas Eve and in the year ahead. Guide us out of darkness and into your joyous light. May our lives reflect your glorious love, that others may see your Christmas spirit in us, each and every day of our lives. Amen. And now I invite you to hear these words from Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. And this was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house of the family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the end.
Sleep, my little Jesus, on a bed of hay. What a shepherd's homeward journey on their way. Mother is thy shepherd, will her vigil keep. Did the voices wake thee, O sleep, my Jesus, sleep. Sleep, my little Jesus, while thou art my home. Hearken, as thy neighbors, shalt thou have a throne. Will thee call me blessed, shall I stand and weep? Be it far, Jehovah, or sleep, my sleep, my little Jesus, wonder baby mine. Will the singing angels greet thee as divine? Through the heart as heaven, lo, the echo sweep. Glory to
now we hear the rest of the story from Luke 2, verses 8 through 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, they made known what had happened, what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, as it had been told to them. May the church hear what the Holy Spirit is trying to tell us this evening.
O holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Divine. us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. His power and glory evermore proclaim. His
Friends, our sermon series, Company's Coming, continues. For tonight, we are now welcoming the guest. You've heard the scriptures read. Our guest is Jesus. So all through Advent, we have been preparing ourselves to receive this up-and-coming guest. We had to get all our messes cleaned up. We had to get the decorations out, right? We needed to make sure that everything is spot on for our guests. We also knew the special company we'd be receiving. Of course, it's Jesus. And so on this Christmas Eve, once again, we welcome Jesus into our lives at his birth. Lord and Savior, ready or not, Jesus is here, coming into our lives once again. So you heard the scriptures read. Mary and Joseph, they had to go to Bethlehem. Nobody over there was getting ready for company. Nobody there was putting up decorations. No, the village was crowded with people coming around from all parts of the area. This census that had to be taken by Rome, no doubt for tax purposes, had to make sure that we knew how many were there, that we could get the amount of money in mind that would be needed to build all those wonderful buildings and baths in Rome. So Mary and Joseph, they're finally able to secure a place for a birth. It wasn't in some motel or even someone's room. But I'm sure the anxiety of not being able to find a decent place contributed to the labor pains that Mary was experiencing. So, Jesus is born and put into a manger. So with the manger, we know they were shown the stable. Did somebody put up decorations in the stable? Probably not. Did somebody clean up the stable? We can only hope so. So the story continues as Luke shares that some of the shepherds were watching their sheep during the night. Questions there too. Would wild animals try to come in and snatch some sheep for food? Or would there be some thieves lurking about wanting to snatch some of the sheep as well, either for food, for wool, or to sell them to another shepherd? So the shepherds had to be on guard, and they were continually probably thinking about these two scenarios. However, they didn't think of another scenario which would soon be upon them, and that is the divine messenger, an angel of the Lord, coming to share with them good news. In this case, yeah, it is good news. Now, we don't know about the shepherd's theology or any expectations they might have had about life. On a scale of 1 to 10, sheep herding was hovering about a 1 or a 2, and that depending on the polls taken that day. But the message to the shepherds was very clear. Births are usually ordinary, but this birth, Mary's, was different. And the clear message for the shepherds is that this birth is out of the ordinary. How often does a long-ago King David get mentioned in conversations? A Messiah? Someone who is anointed? Someone who is going to bring salvation? God is favoring us shepherds with such a message? Shepherds get the message. Did Augustus Caesar, resting in his place way back in Rome, did he get the message? In his view, he'd already saved the world, right? With his Roman legions going out and bringing peace to the empire through violence. King Herod wasn't in the loop either. Why would the king of the Jews not be told that a new king was coming? So we need to visit Matthew's gospel to get the scoop there. It would take some outsiders coming into Jerusalem to inquire about this newborn king of the Jews. And of course, as Matthew shares with us, all of Jerusalem shook. So the shepherds had to get moving. They needed to see for themselves. They're told about the manger and what that meant. They had to look for a stable or a cave, a place where animals were kept. At least they didn't have to clean up. The smell of sheep would just blend in with the other animals. So the shepherds eventually find the Holy Family. They share what they experience in the fields. Mary listens. Her ears hang on every word spoken. Can you imagine that? The shepherds seem empowered by their experience. They see the baby. And of course, Mary ponders the words told to her. How could they fully understand at that moment, at that time, that God incarnate was in Jesus, lying in a feeding trough? A spiritual seeker came to a rabbi and asked, "Teacher, why doesn't anyone see God nowadays?" "The people aren't willing to look that low," the rabbi replied. "They say that the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem has a tiny doorway, so small that anyone passing through has to stoop low in order to enter." "How appropriate. For we do not come to Christ ever by exalting ourselves. We come to him only by bowing low, by bending knee, and following the example of the shepherds and the magi of old." The shepherds are not exalting themselves. They were the salt of the earth. They came to witness what was told to them by the angel of the Lord, and they are beholding to an important part of the story, of history, and that is salvation history. Frederick Buchner writes in his book, Beyond Words, Daily Readings in the ABCs of Faith, he writes, "The true history of humankind and the true history of each individual has less to do than we tend to think with the kind of information that gets into most histories, biographies, and autobiographies. True history has to do with the saving and losing of souls. And both of these are apt to take place when most people, including the one whose soul is at stake, are looking the other way. The real turning point in our lives is less likely to be the day we win the election or get married than the morning we decide not to mail the letter or the afternoon we watch the woods fill up with snow. No, the real turning point in human history is less apt to be the day the wheel is invented or Rome falls than the day a child is born in a stable. Many important things happen through history, and as Buchner states, it's a child that is born in a stable that is the turning point of history. God appears in flesh in the form of a baby. God comes to us in a very vulnerable way. Martin Luther once wrote that God had to use baby talk to get our attention. And sometimes adult can't handle adult talk. But when adults get near a baby, all control is lost. The baby gets the attention. The passage we heard in the light in the Advent wreath, Christ candle lighting, is also about history. God was working then as well to bring peace and hope to Judah. There was darkness back then. If we think about the geopolitical situation, there were the threats of Assyria, Samaria, and Syria. Judah was just stuck in between these nations. So there was darkness and uncertainty about what might happen to us as a people. Isaiah shares, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light, and those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined." Ahaz was not really a very good king, and you can read about that in the scriptures. He decided to ultimately bribe the Assyrians to leave him alone. But Isaiah shares God's vision for either a prince who will one be a king someday or a new king. And this wonderful king, this new king, will embody these positive attributes. Let's hear them again. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. God will see that this happens. So God is always working through history to help us when we need it the most. And God ultimately decides to be with us in the person of Jesus. So the first Christmas begins and has been celebrated for over 2,000 years now. In an article from the Presbyterian Outlook entitled Christ and Christmas, Michael Linville writes this: "The fact that Christmas has everywhere and from its beginnings combined the sacred with the secular is actually theologically fitting. The Christian Christmas is an annual liturgical affirmation of the doctrine of the Incarnation, the bold assertion that in Jesus Christ, God has invaded human space and time." So it was in the 4th and 5th centuries, the God who took on flesh invaded that body Roman Saturnalia with its feasting and role reversals and infused it with Christ. Christmas feasting became an affirmation of the generosity of the Creator and the goodness of creation. Social roles were still reversed, but in a new way, as the child born to peasants in a stable became the sovereign of heaven and earth. Great gift-bearing magi from the east kneeling at the feeding trough where he lay. The God who took on flesh likewise invaded Aurelian's soul invictus, the, quote, unconquered sun, and injected Christ, quote, the true light which enlightens everyone. In the early Middle Ages, the God who took on flesh invaded pagan German winter solstice trees and made them into Christmas trees. The God who took on flesh invaded heathen Scandinavian evergreen circles and made them into Advent wreaths. The God who once deigned to take on mortal flesh can, we should still trust, still invade our present day fleshy, flashy, earthly Christmas in all its hoopla. There's much to be said for Christians to put Christ back into Christmas. Congregations singing Christmas hymns and pastors preaching Christmas sermons do exactly that. But even as the faithful stubbornly keep Christ in Christmas, we would do well to remember that Christ has long done a remarkably good job of keeping Christ in Christmas. Even a pandemic cannot keep Christ out of Christmas. Our Lord continues to be with us during each and every moment of history since that momentous turning point so long ago. Just like you and I experienced life, God experiences life the same way we do now. There will be laughter and tears. There will be joyous moments of healing. There will be pain and suffering. And even for Jesus, the cross. In the dark times, we are reminded in John's gospel, quote, "What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it." Death could not erase the light of Jesus. This Christmas is different. We can all admit that. There is a darkness of pandemic. However, no darkness can extinguish the light of Christ. That's what we can hold on to. We still celebrate his birth. We still count on him to help us in troubling times of life. and to celebrate those joyous times of life. We still do what we can to welcome the company of Jesus into our lives and into our hearts. Christmas is and always will be a joyful remembrance of Jesus coming into the world in the form of a babe. Amen. Now, friends, it's time for us to take up our virtual offering, remembering that God has been generous to give us Jesus, that we too can be generous back to God. So let us pray. Dear God, we cannot thank you enough for the gift of your Son. Through your grace, you have given us everything, including our very lives. On this night, we celebrate the miracle of Christmas. But when the candles are blown out, when the ringing of bells have ceased, when the angels and shepherds have gone home, may we continue to shine your light into the world through the giving of these offerings. And so we offer you yet another gift, our partnership to build your reign here on earth. Amen. Now, friends, let us pray as I offer this Christmas prayer. O God, you are never revealed so completely as in the face of the child of Bethlehem. Hear us as we give you thanks for those who today reveal your love in our world in his Spirit. We pray for those who give you hands by doing their best toward their brothers and sisters, for those who give you a mouth by speaking words of justice and peace for the broken and oppressed, for those who give your poverty the look of hope for your reign, revealing you simply by being your children, reflecting your beauty, as did your only Son, Jesus. We hold up in prayer the lonely and the hurting, the hungry and the homeless, the sick and dispossessed, knowing that your heart has always been nearest to those who are poor in spirit and least likely to be thought of people touched by the hand of divinity. As we remember how you came to live among us in the flesh, and as we celebrate that moment long ago, which lives forever in the hearts of those who believe, and as we long for your fullness in our lives, that we too might enflesh the goodness and love of Christ in our day, we ask that you bless us, your church, to be food for the hungry and hope for those who are lost and alone, a living testament of Christ's faithfulness to you. May all who drink of your one Spirit receive new life to give to those in our world who are thirsty and poor meaning and belonging. Pour your Spirit upon us, your people. Continue in our lives the mystery of Christmas. Let your Son become flesh in us so that we may reveal you to our world all the days of our lives. Holy Child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. cast out sin, and enter in, be born in us today. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus, who, with you and the Holy Spirit, live and reign, one God forever and ever, and who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, friends, we're going to close our service by singing Silent Night. We're going to symbolically lift our candles up to the sky to show that we are indeed illumined by the light of Christ. So let's now begin. Blessed, peaceful, Merry Christmas.
Thank you.